I can't believe that people wanted to develop on a 5,000-year-old bog. There were forces that really wanted this land to be developed, but there were a lot of really great people that said no.
Right behind me, we see a high-rise. It's condominiums. There's Walmart and a shopping mall over on that side. Here we have a little piece of land right in the core of urban Richmond that's conserved for agriculture or conserved for the natural environment. It's quite amazing. This is a really important site because we're here on the edge of the Greater Lulu Island peat bog. And one of the exciting things about a bog is that when they pull carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, it stays there. It isn't released back into the atmosphere. And that's because there just aren't a lot of bacteria or fungi that would break that material down and release it back as carbon dioxide. And in the process, it's really helping battle climate change. So the peat itself is made of layers and layers of ancient sphagnum. This is sphagnum that I've transplanted because I'm really trying to get sphagnum growing again in this part of the bog. That soil doesn't break down over time. So this is something that's remarkable about the bog environment, is that all of that organic matter just stays there. And it's really sequestering carbon. When I moved here, I didn't know anything about peat. I've been learning about peat and just amazed by its capacity to hold on to carbon. And this has made me want to spread the word, want to tell everybody I can about peat. I'm just talking about it constantly because I think it's so exciting.
It's an inspirational story because there were all kinds of plans to develop this piece of land. And there was a particular group of people at that time that were sitting around a kitchen table and they said to each other, we don't want that to happen. So it was a big fight, just a heart-wrenching experience. Now, once the lands were saved, our society changed its name to the Garden City Conservation Society, and we've continued to this day to do stewardship activities on the Garden City lands. And we've also been working in collaboration with KPU on the sphagnum moss research project.
The Sustainable Agriculture Program here at KPU started about 12 years ago. Our country, our cities have changed dramatically, and so we felt that there was a need to shape our courses, the experiences that our students have, our partners, in a way that is laser focused on these really critical issues that we need to address today in order to think about how do we reimagine our food system for tomorrow. Our students spend a lot of time on this farm as well, and they have played a huge role in shaping it, and both in their research, in the work that they do on the site. They bring all kinds of new ideas.
I was a farm assistant last year, so I interacted a lot with people at the farmers market. In my new role as the outreach coordinator, I started this section of the learning garden that we're standing in right now. It's here to really represent what's going on in the farm, but in a more digestible way for the community.
Being a university farm, it's a much more diverse and interesting role than just growing food. And we also do lots of on-farm applied research. So students are doing different research projects that range from looking at how to grow rice in alternative ways to reduce methane emissions and water use. As an organic farm, we are really trying to take an integrated approach. So trying to, and I think quite successfully, developing an ecosystem of predators that will feed on some of our problematic insects. Okay, so here we are in the cucumbers, and we're seeing something a little bit unusual, that we have aphids that are on the underside of this cucumber leaf, and you can see how they're all clustered together, so they reproduce really quickly there.
We're seeing white fly. There's the white fly adult, but that's the spider mite down there. And then, and one of the first clues when I'm seeing spider mites, I first see the webbing. And so you see that kind of like sheath of webbing above the spider mites, and then these tiny little spider mites here. It's amazing how much has changed, isn't it?
Yeah, it's incredible.
I was in conversation with Andy, the farm manager, and he was mentioning how it was difficult to figure out how to manage cover crops doing no-till. Mm-hmm. And so I was doing some research, and I thought we could try a mow and cover method. Mm-hmm. So it was a really successful method, and actually something that we were able to adopt this year on the farm.
What we want to do is help people foster and start to develop their own story around food and place and what that means to them.
You know, I feel emotional saying this, but it's just, this is a priceless gift for all of our future generations. Something like this that's saved, and it's under such loving care. And it's just, it makes my heart sing.